students, a very good morning. So students, in last class we have started since last 2 days we are just discussing about the chapter elasticity. So today let's discuss the rest of the things of the chapter. So here in the chapter up to the topic of elastic constraints we have discussed, and in the case of elastic constraint, the two types of elastic constraint like Young's modulus of elasticity and bulk modulus of elasticity, both we have discussed up to now. And compressibility, that topic we have also discussed. So the third topic or third type of elastic constraint that we have to discuss today, that is the modulus of rigidity. So let's see now what is the modulus of rigidity, third type of elastic constraint, that is now known as modulus of rigidity. So modulus of rigidity we are also denoting it by the symbol, that is now eta. So eta or this modulus of rigidity obtained just like same as using Hooke's law. So Hooke's law is what? That is, within the elastic unit, the stress that is directly proportional to the strain, and if you will solve that proportionality, you will get some proportionality constraint, and that is now known as modulus of elasticity or elastic constraint. And if we will start to add here the same or changing configuration, and in particular configuration, if we are talking about the change in shape, so that change in shape, you know, that can obtain only due to application of tangential force or shearing force. So it means the strain that is produced here, this is known as shearing stress, and the strain means the change in configuration occurred due to the application of stress, that is also change in shape. So we are calling change in shape to the original shape as shearing of strain. So this too we have discussed before, and now this is known as modulus of rigidity. So exactly, modulus of rigidity is defined as the ratio of shearing stress to the shearing strain. To understand this concept, let's consider we have a square set body, and on this square set body we are asked, suppose the cylinder is L, we are applying a force here along its standing, means one end we have kept fixed, along one end we have applied the force, suppose this is now the square PQRS, so along the side PQ we have applied the force F for this one. So we will apply the force per unit area, then we can calculate the shearing stress here. The shearing stress will be what? That will be the force per unit area there. And now due to application of this force, only this side that will be facing the change in configuration, and due to its change in configuration, it starts to be extended along this limb, and that's why its shape will start to distort. And due to distortion, this point suppose that's U-dash. So the new shape of the y, this whole square will become like P-dash U-dash as a. So it means it will become the parallelogram. So this we have seen due to the application of tangential force here, that strain that is created, that change its shape. And this shape, if you will see its change, then this can be calculated in the terms of now theta again. So let's see now how can we calculate shearing stress and how can we calculate shearing strain in both of the cases. And as here stress, if you will see, so that stress that is calculated just to apply here, that is obviously force per unit area, and the strain is what? If you will see the strain, so exactly in the form of angle you can see, or also you can see it by change in length. So if this is suppose the change that is occurred, this is delta L, so obviously the other one, P dash Q dash, this will be obviously equal to this delta L, but here if the length you will see, this is changed by the delta L, this is shifted by the delta L. So we can calculate the strain here. So this strain will be what? In this case also, this strain is given by delta L by L. Now, if we will calculate tan theta in this equation, so you can see here a triangle PP dash and R. So in the triangle PP dash R, tan theta if we will calculate, so obviously that will be perpendicular upon base. So this perpendicular is what? That is now delta L by L. So here our perpendicular is delta L, and this is suppose square set is obviously side will be same. So this is also L, and this is now material or the system, whether they will be deformed or not, on the application of deforming force. So here you can see, if this eta is very greater, then for that case, this deformation, this will be very small. So exactly, if you have some of the wire, how much it is tensed or torsion is created in that wire, that can be calculated by using its property of modulus of rigidity. So exactly this word, why we are calling it modulus of rigidity, it tells us about how rigid the body is. So if you have to differentiate the rigidity of the body, then that time we are comparing this modulus of here, or the elastic constant, that is also known as modulus of rigidity. So I think this three, first of all, these three are now clear. Three kinds of elastic constraints we have. First one was Young's modulus of elasticity, second one was bulk modulus of elasticity, and third one was modulus of rigidity. So these all we have calculated now. So let's see the next topic after this discussion on these three types of materials here. So that discussion after this particular topic is now for the case of first comparison of all these three. So in the case of comparison of all these three, if you will see, like if the body has Young modulus, bulk modulus, and modulus of rigidity. So in this one, solid or gaseous system or liquid system, which can have which kind of their elastic constraint. So first one type of elastic constraint, modulus of rigidity. First, let's start from here. So as it is telling us about the rigid body. So rigid body we are obtaining whenever we have solid bodies. So this kind of things we are observing only for the solids. Next one here, if you will see Young's modulus, then Young's modulus also, if you will see, that is involved with solid also, because it is related to the change in length. So length is the property of solid. So that's why this property of Young's modulus of elasticity, that can be only obtained in case of solids. Bulk modulus, if you will see, so bulk modulus is involved with solid, liquid, and gases. So this is involved with what? Because all the these kind of systems that involves with the volume, whenever you will just keep fluid somewhere, then it acquires the shape of that vessel. So that's why it is acquiring the volume. So volume concept or change in volume or application of force to change its volume, that will involve in the gas fluid system as well as in solid system. So bulk modulus we are observing for all. Next one, if you will see or relate the bulk moduli for solid, that will be greater than the bulk moduli of liquid, and that will be also greater than the bulk moduli of gaseous system. So it means that bulk modulus start to decrease from solid to gaseous system. So as you know, solid have compact shape, the relative distance between the molecules, that is very small, and due to that small distance, obviously whenever we will apply the force, then that time they will start to compressed, or they will start, so you can say the change in its volume, that will be small even due to their compact nature. But we can compress more liquid and gaseous system. So the as compressibility of liquid and gaseous systems are greater, their bulk modulus will be smaller, because we have seen bulk modulus is inversely proportional to the compressibility, and we can compress gaseous system more than the liquid, and liquid can be more compressible than the solid. So that's why bulk modulus of solid is greater in comparison to the liquid, and liquid is greater in comparison to the gaseous system. So this is now the next comparison. Next one, if you will come to the topic of modulus of rigidity. So modulus of rigidity, if you will see, so obviously this is involved with the solid bodies, and also for the liquid, if you will see, for ideal liquid it is zero, because ideal liquid is not acquiring any shape size, it is not acquiring any volume. But whenever you will see any liquid, that is at rest, particular situation is here, liquid at rest, that acquires volume, that will be somewhere that where we have kept it. So at that case only we can have the modulus of rigidity, otherwise we will not have this kind of rigidity for the liquids also. So that is, I think, the three things are clear where we will get these kind of properties. It means that if we have to discuss about the solid, then that time for solid materials we need all these three types of elasticity: modulus of rigidity, bulk modulus, and Young modulus. So these are all the properties of solid, and we are using materials, we are choosing materials for our purpose in accordance with here. one. Let's start to discuss stress strain relationship in a wire. So next one.
So the part of, you can see from part A to B, it is
here. So if a wire is unloaded by at point B, then it means that the graph between stress and strain follow the reverse path BAO. This path it will starts to follow, and now this point B is known as elastic limit. So our point B is what? This is now called elastic limit. So why we are calling it elastic limit? If beyond this point, up to this point B, you have applied stress, and for this stress we have obtained strength. But when we will remove this stress suddenly, then this wire will start to come back to this old path. Means BAO, means it will regain its original shape and size. But whenever you will move beyond B, that time from B to C, if again you have applied the stress, even a small stress you have applied, the variation in the strain you can see. And for this B to C point, again after coming to this point C, if you will remove the force that you have applied, then you can trace the graph of this one, you can meet this point, and you can see here this obtained a variation in this original length. Means some of the length that is distorted, that is changed from the original one. Now we can say this wire starts to deform now. It will start to gain some of the plastic behavior. So up to the point, it is beyond the point B, the body will start to deform. But within point B, body will originally regain its shape and size, but it will not feel any kind of deformation. So that's why this point is known as now elastic limit point. Next one, if you will see the region up to OB, this is known as elastic region. So as beyond this point, the point C you are seeing, this point C is known as here deformation point, or we are also calling this kind of behavior of the system, it is known as permanent sac, or also we are saying it plastic deformation. So just now I have to explain to you why we are saying this one. Permanent sac means if you will after application of this force equal to this one, stress equal to this, if you will remove the stress, even then body will regain or shape and size, but with some deformation. You can see the deformation that is equal to OO dash, and this deformation will be permanent in the body because it is not experiencing any force. Even then it has this kind of even deformation. So we are saying it is start to be deformed, or this region OBC, you are saying this is known as now plastic deformation region, or we are saying this OO dash as the permanent set. So this word permanent set is I think now clear. Now next, if you will see now from C to D, now this point C to D, let me just make it first for it. This kind of graph is exactly this one. This C to D. So up to the point C to D, we are seeing the stress that is near about constant. So stress is constant, means whenever the body will reach to its permanent set point, then up to the point C to D, even we will not apply any stress, we will constrain the stress, we will not increase the stress, but strain will automatically produced in the system. Means the system will start to deform by its own way, by its own. So that's why we are saying that body will start to flow down. Means wire, if you will start to strain it, up to a point, if you will just remove even deforming force, then wire will start to flow. So we are saying this point C as the yield point, or this region is known as yield region. So exactly this point C is now known as yield point. So here also I can write it, that is why we yield point. So yield point is what? Up to which the point body will regain its shape size, but beyond this one, if stress will be at and that time even body will start to flow down up to the point D. Means up to this point it is not occurring, up to this strain it is not obtaining, that will start to flow in the outer atmosphere. Next one here, if beyond D again we will start to stress increase the stress, then body will start to again strain in the linear manner from B to E, again start to just be stressed now. So up to from D to E, again it is going to be stressed, and at that time when it reaches to the point E, so this point E is what? This is first known as ultimate strain point. So what is now this ultimate strain point? Means up to this point, the body will or the wire will bear the stress. So here, up to point E, the wire will extended, continuously extended, and it is bearing the stress. But whenever we will increase the stress beyond this point E, then that time again its strain will starts to decrease, but that means the wire will starts to break. So this point F is known as now breaking point. So the last one point that we are observing, this is now what? Breaking point. So exactly these are now the stress-strain relationship in any wire that we are observing, and these points are telling us in detail about the behavior of any material whenever we are applying continuous strain, stress, and we are just seeing continuous strain that is produced in the system. So for the application of continuous stress up to this point A, it will completely obey the Hooke's law. So that's why we are calling it point of proportional limit. A to B, if it will go, means if from B you will remove the deforming force, it will regain its shape and size. But exactly it is not a straight line, that's why we cannot call it it is obeying Hooke's law. It is even not obeying Hooke's law, but it has elastic property. So that's why B point is known as this elastic limit. Beyond B point, B to C, you can see the wire starts to get deformation, and due to that deformation it starts to get permanent set, and this C is known as yield point, or we are also calling the wire has yield strength. Means even it can have some of the permanent set, but still it can regain its shape and size from there, or its configuration from there. After C to D, the wire starts to flow down even without application of stress. So that point C to D, we are saying it, this is the you can say yield reason of this one, or we are saying it the wire starting to flow reason, we are also calling it plastic deformation reason, we are also calling it all. Next, after reaching to D, where again when we start to increase the stress, then for increment of the stress, again strain will start to increase in the linear way, and up to the point E, it will bear that stress, it will strain, and this point E is known as ultimate strain point. And if beyond the strain, this ultimate strain point, we will apply the stress, then wire will break down. So here, this is now the whole of the stress-strain relationship. So students, I think this strain-stress relationship and these all points that are very important points to understand this one, that is now clear. So for today, I think this topic we have cleared. Then in next class, we will see where we can apply this knowledge of stress-strain relationship in the wire, which kind of material we can here make by using these knowledge of this elasticity. So later in next class, we will see about the different kinds of elastic materials. Also, we will see some small things about the elastic material, or the material that we are using, which kind of properties they have, like we are feeling tiredness, so they are also feeling. So these all we will discuss. So for today, I think all the things are now students clear. So let's end.